Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. We want to see you. Hallelujah. The angels sing, holy, holy, holy. Holy is the Lamb. Holy is the Lamb. The Bible says in 2 Chronicles 7 and 14, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and I will heal the land. I don't know about anybody else this morning, Double Portion, but I believe that our land is in need of a healing. So we come this morning, Holy Spirit, to ask you to just have your way. We ask you that you illuminate yourself to us, that you lead us and guide us in all truth this morning. God, we are your people and you are our God. So we Double Portion Kingdom Ministries. We come this morning asking you to open up our hearts, God. Open up our hearts, God, to this new thing that you're doing, to this way that you're moving. God, we're here on location this morning in Dallas, Texas. And God, we're not in the church, but we are the church. So God, we come this morning casting all of our care on you because we know that you care for us. Now, God, we know that some of our people, they're going through, God. They're in some situations and some circumstances. God, we pray for Bishop Rush, God, who eulogized his wife on yesterday, God. God, you said in your word that many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers them from them all. So God, we know we come this morning walking in a spirit of victory. God, defeat is not an option. Defeat is not an option. We come this morning walking in the spirit of victory, God, and we decree and declare that we shall never give up, that we shall keep on fighting. There's a song that says, fight on, O soldier. God, we come as soldiers on the battlefield for the Lord. You said, God, if we lean not to our own understanding, but acknowledge you in all we do, that you will direct our path. So, God, we don't come as valley dwellers, but we come this morning as faith walkers. You said if we had faith just the size of a mustard seed, that we could move mountains. So, God, we come this morning walking by faith and not by sight. So we come this morning putting on our spiritual lenses, God, to see this thing as you see it. God, we pray in the name of Jesus for this world, for this country, for each and every city represented here. We pray especially, God, for the city of Chicago on this morning in the name of Jesus, God. God, we are your people. You called us by your name. So, God, we come humbly, God, seeking you, God. Hallelujah. Humbly seeking you, God, this way. And, God, we decree and declare in the name of Jesus, God, that we will turn our face to wickedness on this morning, God. But, God, that we'll follow you. Now, God, I pray for each and every person within the sound of my voice. You know what it is that you're wrestling with this morning. But, God, we come like Jacob. We're not going to let you go this morning until you bless us. So God, have your way. Move like only you can. We bind any demonic interferences in the airways this morning in the name of Jesus. We loose the spirit of freedom this morning. We pray that people will be set free, healed, and delivered. Now, God, as your word goes forth this morning, we pray for a fresh anointing that destroys yokes. We pray, God, that you anoint your people's ears to hear what thus says the Lord. So as we go higher in worship this morning, God, we come in a posture of worship. God, we drown out each and everything that we're dealing with, the things that are bothering us, God. We drown out the things of the world. We come in a posture of worship. So God, let us right now shift into a posture of worship. Holy Spirit, have your way this morning. Move like only you can. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Hallelujah and bless God. Hallelujah.
Distracted devotion for Thank you, Jesus. I want to see you, God. I want to see you with absolutely no distractions. God, we come this morning just praising you, glorifying you, magnifying you, exalting you, lifting you up, oh God, even as the worship has gone forward this morning. Thank you, God, that we came praising you, saying, worthy is your name. We came acknowledging Holy Spirit's presence in the place on today, and even the song, give me dove's eyes. What are dove's eyes? Those are the eyes that lock in on its point, and I will not be distracted by anything else going on. Dove's eyes, give me the eyes of Holy Spirit. One of the symbols in the word of God for Holy Spirit is a dove. Give me dove's eyes, undistracted devotion, for only you, God. Let me not be distracted by the things of this world and the cares of this world, but only see you, only press into you, only God. You are my focus. My eyes are focused to see you. Give me dove's eyes, God, on this morning. And so we thank you and we praise you. Double Portion Kingdom Ministries, get ready. Get your Bible, get your pen, or just wait for the YouTube to come back to grab your notes as we go forward on this morning with our topic. I can see clearly now. I can see clearly now is our topic for this morning. So let's go forward and read our theme scripture. This morning, God, I thank you. I thank you, God, for the theme scripture this morning that you have placed in my heart to come forward and to share on this morning out of Mark chapter 8. Mark chapter 8. Turn to it. We're going to read a few verses together and we'll just dive right in. Mark chapter 8, verse 22 through 26. And I'm reading it out of the Passion Translation. It says, when they arrived at Bethsaida, some people brought a blind man to Jesus, begging him to touch him and heal him. So Jesus led him as his sighted guide outside the village. He placed his saliva on the man's eyes, there it is again, and covered them with his hands. Then he asked him, now do you see anything? Yes, he said, my sight is coming back. I'm beginning to see people, but they look like trees, walking trees. Jesus put his hands over the man's eyes a second time and made him look up, look up, look up. The man opened his eyes wide and he could see everything perfectly. His eyesight was completely restored. And then our last verse, then Jesus sent him home with these instructions. Go home, but don't tell anyone what happened, not even the people of your own village. God, we thank you for those dove's eyes, those eyes to see, even as Jesus said of himself in Luke 4:18, that you caused him to bring sight, recovery of sight to the blind as we go forward on this morning, as in the last 3 weeks. We thank you that we will tap into this recovery of sight to the blind. I once was blind, but now I see because he touched me, and he didn't just touch me. He commingled his DNA with my DNA for seeing, and that's where the dove's eyes come into play. So God, I thank you as we go forward. Let your servant Paulette Denise decrease, that you, oh God, would increase, that we would have seeing eyes to see clearly what you are saying to us and what you have been saying to us for the last 3 weeks as we have put some feet on our faith, as we, oh God, have come and understood that it's in my DNA, and we come this week saying, I can see clearly now. Double Portion, you know my 2021 assignment from Holy Spirit is to always open the parables of the kingdom. And you're saying, how is she going to bring a parable out of this? Well, glad you asked. This verse 22 through 26 are actually a parabolic answer to everything that was right above. Look in your Bible right there in Mark chapter 8. Everything that was going on and taking place in the book of Mark, the answer is right here at verse 22. And so as we go forward and look at this thing and see what God was saying in Mark chapter 8, verses 1 through 10, it reveals the compassion of Jesus Christ. It reveals the fact that the Holy Spirit had compassion upon the people. And these weren't weren't just believers. These were non-believers that were hearing the gospel for the very first time. And the compassion of Jesus fed them. It caused a miracle, miraculous compassion manifested on behalf of the people. But then what happened next, verse 11 through 13, there was a confrontation of the Pharisees where they were coming and they were trying to jam Jesus up. But then at verse 14 through 15, there is a careful consideration where Jesus is telling the disciples to beware of the leaven, the yeast of the Pharisees, their evil influence to try and fight and bicker and get caught up on the minors and major on the law instead of Jesus who fulfilled the law that was in their presence. And then there was a confusion that took place, verse 16 through 21, as the disciples were confused because he talked about yeast. They thought he was talking about bread, but it was not about bread. They had a lack of understanding. And then we get to our text right here at verse 22 through 26, where comes a clarity of what he was really talking about. Now, it would look that because at verse 22, you have my sermon notes right there. We're going to walk through the notes together right there, my sermon notes in your hand. At verse 22, it says, and when they came to Bethsaida, and people brought to him a blind man and begged him to touch him. This is out of the Amplified rendition. That word Bethsaida means a house of fish. So yeah, I saw this graphic that says even Jesus went fishing. So they were at Bethsaida, which means a house of fish. And this time they brought the blind man to him. In the text that we looked at in the last 2 weeks, Jesus saw the blind man. So my thing is this, whether the blindness, Jesus sees it or someone brings him to you, this is why Double Portion is constantly reaching out. You get these reminder texts and things like this. We're constantly trying to get you to connect with Jesus. We're bringing you to Jesus so that sight, recovery of sight can take place, so that spiritual sight, that Jesus can touch you with his spiritual DNA. Come on. So Bethsaida means a house of fish. Jesus went fishing. And so they brought the blind man to him. Blind man, that word blind means mentally blind. The Greek meaning was, it meant darkened with smoke. So all the smoke of the Pharisees, do you see how it's a parable? All the smoke of the Pharisees trying to make you think something is, the smoke screens will darken you and cause you to see things the wrong way. Know this, that scientifically, the eye is the second most complex organ next to the brain. It has over 2 million parts in the eye, and the eye has the fastest muscle in our body to be able to blink. And so these are just some things for us to understand how the enemy, why is he constantly assaulting us? This is not in my notes. In 2 Corinthians, we are told to pull down the strongholds, the thoughts that try and keep us from believing in Jesus, the community of God. Jesus. Now, I know in this text, it's only talking about Jesus, but wherever they're talking about Jesus, they're talking about the community of God, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. Jesus even said of Holy Spirit that he is going to take the things that are mine and give them unto you, we, the disciples. So God is showing us some things through the power of Holy Spirit, illuminating unto us the significance of understanding that Jesus went to a place of fish, that Jesus acknowledge this blind man that was there that was speaking. Everyone, please mute your phone. I can't mute you, whoever that was that just called in. If you can mute your phone, thank you so much. As we continue to go forward, and God, you get the glory, the honor, the praise out of what's going on. We thank you, God, that you see and know what's going on with us. So we thank you, God, that even as the blind man was there, God, you get the glory, you get the honor, you get the praise, oh Lord. We thank you. We thank you for what was happening right here, that this blind man begged to touch him. And God showed me a meaning of this word beg. When I was in Tulsa some 16 years ago, I saw a man, I was walking in the midst, it was 98 degrees outside, but I had to get to where I was going. So I'm walking, I'm sweating from head to toe, getting where I need to go. And this man was holding up a sign, and the sign said, I'd rather beg than steal. And it hit me in my spirit. I said, me too. to. I'd rather beg than steal, but my beg is different from the worldly beg. My beg is, I'd rather believe Elohim, God. I'd rather beg than steal. I'd rather believe Elohim, God. I'd rather believe Elohim, God. I'd rather reach out and allow him to touch me, position myself to be touched by him. So our 3 points out of verse 22 was understanding that Jesus went fishing among men. A blind man was brought to him, and last week he recognized the blind man. And what we ought to do with that blindness is believe Elohim God for our vision. Let's go on to verse 23. It says, and he caught the blind man by the hand. He caught him by the hand. Holy Spirit caught the blind man by. Remember last week, Pastor Don was saying, how is he going to know how to walk to where he was telling him to go? Holy Spirit was leading him. So here, the Holy Spirit will grab you by the hand. See, he can operate whichever way he chooses to operate, whether he will lead you or he will grab you by the hand. So Jesus was the seeing eyes to the blind man. Will you be the hands and feet of Jesus? Are you able to grab someone by the hand and lead them to a place where they can be touched by Jesus? That word hand, figuratively speaking, it symbolizes God's might, his activity, his power in creating the universe and in upholding it and protecting it. It also symbolizes his hand in punishment. It also symbolizes his hand in determining and controlling the destinies of men. So Jesus led him by his hand. He led him by his hand and he led him out of the village. Jesus led him by his hand, a place of authority, but he took him outside of the village. That word village, it's a common sleeping place to which laborers in the field return. That's what the village is. It is a common sleeping place to which laborers in the field return. So there are many people that are laboring in the field, but who are you laboring for? I said it's a parable. They're laboring. The Pharisees were doing a lot of laborious things, but their motives were wrong. So he led them outside of the place where the other laborers were because Jesus knew that some of them were laboring for the wrong thing. What are your motives for the labor? Are you doing perfection, performance orientation? You're trying to perform to gain a place of clout or an end with God? You're trying to fill up your bank account with God? What are you laboring for? Are you laboring out of the compassion of Jesus Christ? But here's another thing that Holy Spirit showed me. I was asking, why did he lead him outside of the village? Why? Because Jesus actually, I found that he was criticizing and putting a mark on Bethsaida. On your own, go to Matthew chapter 11, verse 20 through 22. Matthew chapter 11, verse 20 through 22. We can see where Jesus is telling he said to Bethsaida, he said, denounce the towns where he made all these miracles. They're available for them, but none of them turn to God. So Jesus was like, I'm going to heal this man, but I'm not going to do it in the presence of non-believers, people that have had time and time and time again to believe me. Let me just take you away from that because I don't want them to hinder what it is that I'm going to do for you. And this is why we have to acknowledge, if we're blind in some areas, acknowledge it. Jesus knows whether he's going to heal us right in front of everybody or take us by the hand, by his authority, by his knowing, and lead us outside of where the other laborers are so that we can receive our healing. Yeah. Another time that someone was led outside, this hit me in my spirit as I was studying in Genesis 45, when Joseph began to reveal to his brothers who he was. He put everybody else, the people, the commoners, outside of the room and only left the people there that needed to understand his identity within the room right there in Genesis 45. And then I found this note, because Jesus took him away to heal him privately. He healed him it may have been a humiliating way, because remember, the next verse is going to tell us he spit in his eye. That could be humiliating. However, that word humiliate means to humble. He wanted to humble him with compassion privately away from the crowds. Sometimes he'll do it in front of the crowds. Sometimes he'll take you away from the crowd to deal with private issues so that you can receive your healing. Jesus, help us right now. Another reason that he led him away from the crowd is because the crowd was trying to tell him how to do it. So when they brought him, they said, you can heal him. And he was like, I'm not going to do it the way you think I'm going to do it. I'm going to do it in private. He will be healed. It'll be between me and him. How many of you have been healed in private? And it's between you and him. I don't, like the man said on last week, I don't know, but I once was blind, but now I see, whether it was private or whether it was public, now I can see. So he led the man outside of the village. And when he had spit in his eye, when he had spit in his eye, let's talk about spit. Let's talk about saliva. Let's talk about that. To us, in our Greek mind, that's just nasty to spit in someone's eye. How dare you to spit in someone's eye, kobosaka, especially in the climate of where the world is today. Spitting is it's negative. It's terrible. You wouldn't do that. So he didn't want to do that in front of everyone else. It says he had spit on his eye. It didn't say he put it in his hand and put it on his eye. It said he spit on his eye. And what saliva is, that's where the DNA is. I studied some things about saliva, y'all. I'm not going to go deep and technical into everything that I found. But one thing that I found about saliva is that it is 99.5% water and only 0.05% solids. That's where the DNA is, in the 0.05%. So like Pastor Don said on the More Report COVID show, only Jesus can be 100%. Only Heavenly Father. He is 100% your Father. That is in my DNA. He was joining the DNA. He was removing the DNA of whatever caused this man to be blind. And remember last week, the last sessions, he was blind from birth. So he was removing the thing from birth that caused you to be blind. Or maybe you lost your sight through diabetes or something of the sort. He was removing the DNA of the natural and putting a spiritual DNA on him. Another thing that I saw where people, you know, how many of you have heard this? And a lot of us are from the country, so you get it. When they say you ought to lick your wounds. If you got a cut, you lick your hand real fast. Why would people lick their wounds? That came up in my study, so I went and studied it out. What does it mean to lick your wounds? Licking the wounds is an instinctive response in humans and many other animals to lick an injury. It means to recover one's strength or your confidence. Figuratively, it is to recover your strength, your confidence after a defeat or a humiliating experience. So do you see why Jesus took him away so that he can deal with this spit, this DNA in this situation, to do it in private? To lick your wounds figuratively is to recover from defeat. So he took him into a private place so that he could recover from defeat. And this was a note I found, that the spittle signified the eye salve wherewith Christ anoints the eyes of those that are spiritually blind, according to Revelation 3, verse 18, eye salve of God. And that word, God, I thank you for us understanding what it means to that Jesus spit in his eye. Help us come out of the Greek mindset and understand the mind of God, that you were doing a DNA transformation. It wasn't spitting in the natural eye. It's his spiritual eye helping him to see. But guess what? When he spit in his eye, it says he put his hands upon him and asked him, do you possibly see anything? Verse 24 is the answer. He looked up and he said, I see people, but they look like trees walking. Understand, this is a two-stage miracle. I heard somebody say that this is a tremendous miracle. He saw men as trees. It's two stages. So he spit and touched him. It was a gradual healing rather than instantaneous. That's also why he had to do it in private, because you know nowadays people will call you a false in a minute if it doesn't look the way they think it should look. So he had to do it privately. Now the man looked and he had blurred vision instead of clear vision. It was blurred without an understanding of Jesus. It was blurred because he had a religious mindset, or better yet, a rebellious mindset. When I heard that about trees walking, it instantly in my spirit, I heard witchcraft. Trees are used a lot in witchcraft. trees walking is referring to witchcraft. So he saw blurry because he was seeing through a rebellious eye, through a religious eye, through a witchcraft eye. And we understand that rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft. Now you see why I heard that, because he was seeing through rebellious eyes. But what is the answer for rebellious eyes? The answer for sin, the answer, the thing against witchcraft, we can't have vision through the eyes of rebellion, through the eyes of witchcraft, through the eyes of the wrong thing in the supernatural realm. You must see through the eyes of Imago Dei, that we're created in the image of God. And so the answer is to be touched by Jesus. See, that's why he's commingling and he's putting spit in the eye. Physical, but spiritual. The spiritual DNA of Jesus. He's touching us to help us get our focus on him. Remember, he'll keep you in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on them. You're looking at the trees. You're looking at men that look like trees. Hello. Look to the right thing. We need to look to Jesus. As John 3:14 says, look to Jesus. And John 3:14 was actually quoting Numbers 21:9 when the children of Israel were bitten by fiery serpents. Why were they bitten? They were bitten because they were murmuring and complaining. They didn't like the journey that God had them on. This is why we're trying to tell you, don't murmur against the process. Go ahead and rest in the process. Don't be murmuring and complaining, because when you're found murmuring and complaining, you release some ancient serpents to come after you. And we don't need that. The answer to the ancient serpents of old in Numbers 21, verse 19, was for Moses made a serpent of bronze and he put it on a pole. If a serpent had bitten anyone, so if you are guilty of murmuring and complaining, change that thing. Fix your mouth. What are you looking at? Are you seeing men as trees walking? Somebody always doing you wrong and you can't get ahead. Who was there? Who wasn't there? Stop the murmuring and complaining. If you've been bitten by that, look to the cross. Look to Jesus. And the Amplified says, when he looked, whoever was bitten, whoever was caught up in murmuring and complaining, if that's you, check your heart right now. God, if it's, I know I've been murmuring and complaining. Help me get out of murmuring and complaining. Help me get out of being judgmental toward other people. If that's you, the answer is right here, that you would look to the serpent of bronze. Look to Jesus. This is Jesus tearing down the fiery serpents, were things that the enemy, that Pharaoh worshiped. And he allowed, because you're murmuring and complaining, he let you know Pharaoh will come after you. And many died in the wilderness because they were bit by these serpents. But when they repented and they went to their leader, Moses prayed and God told him, this is an instruction from God to make this brazen serpent. And whoever is bit, once you're bit, if you know you've been bit, if you're blind, if you can't see, if you know you've been bit by this fiery serpent, then you need to look to Jesus, the upheld cross, as in John 3:14. John 3:14 is quoting Numbers 21, verse 9. And when you look, don't just look haphazardly. You need to look attentively, expectantly, with a steady and absorbing gaze. When you look like this, you will live. So the gazing touch will change the focus and cause those trees that were men to now be symbolic of the cross of Calvary. It will allow us to see the compassion of Jesus. Therefore, we can see we can have compassion on men and understand, oh, they just caught up in rebellion. Let's intercede for them. Let's not talk about them. Let's not ostracize them. Let's intercede and give the word of God access and entrance into their lives. The tree of the cross will turn the cross into a fishing pole for men. And the bait is compassion. Everybody knows when you go fishing, you have to have a worm or some chicken or some bacon, some kind of flesh as bait. But the bait for fishing men is compassion. They need to know how much you care before they'll pay attention to what you're saying. And the text went on to say he saw them as trees walking. When compassion comes in, they're walking, but you're seeing the walking the wrong way. But when we focus on Jesus, now we see them as men walking. And this word walking means to make one's way, to progress, to make due use of opportunities. Yes, Jesus. In the Hebrew, it means to live, to regulate one's life, to conduct oneself. It means to tread all around. And the root word of that word walking, it means to advance by setting foot upon, to tread upon, to encounter successfully the greatest perils from that which Satan tries to thwart the gospel. So when we understand and we walk looking to Jesus and looking at Jesus, we undo and overcome the screw tape elements. The screw tape element will have you looking at men as trees instead of men. And therefore you mistreat them and you don't have compassion for them. But Jesus touched him one more time. Verse 25, it says, he put his hands on his eyes again. Now this word eyes in verse 25 is a different Greek word from the word eyes that we saw back up in verse 23. The word eyes here in verse 25 is speaking metaphorically of the eyes of the mind. It's the faculty of knowing. It's figuratively, this one here is talking about an envy or jealousy or a side glance. But the one back in verse 23 was talking about eyes of the mind and the power of understanding and discern, the power to discern, to perceive, to discover, to contemplate, to weigh carefully, to examine. So we are to do that, but don't do it with a jealous eye. So Jesus touched him again to get rid of the jealousy that was in his mind. This second touch is his assistance with our Romans 12:2 mandate to renew our mind. So he touched the man again. He touched his eyes again. And the man looked intently, that is, fixed his eyes on definite objects. Like it said back up there in Numbers 21, he looked intently. He fixed his eyes on definite objects and he was restored. That word restore, oh my gosh, it is a three-part meaning. That word restore is of any kind of separation of one thing from another by which the union or fellowship of the two is destroyed. So he was restored what the enemy tried to destroy. The enemy tries to get you looking at through the eyes of religion, through the eyes of rebellion, through the eyes of murmuring and complaining. But Jesus will touch us again because it's the enemy that's envious. It's the enemy that's jealous. Do not focus on him. Focus on God. Understand it as the screw tape element. Put the blood on it and keep on going. Be restored to wholeness. It also means the end. It's the end or the termination. So the term, it's the expiration of you looking at things the wrong way. It's the expiration of you always being in the dark. Jesus, help us. It also means restoration. It is the brightness, the radiance, the daylight. It's the ray of light. It's the break of day. So he touched him and he was restored and he saw everything distinctly. That word distinctly is clearly. Even what was at a distance, he saw it clear. I can see clearly now. And so as we close at verse 26, so now the man is seeing clear. He's seeing all is well. Verse 26 says, and he sent him away to his house, telling him, don't even enter the village or tell anyone there about what happened out here. Basically was what he was saying. And the reason I put a caution and a warning right there is that basically now that this man is saved and he's looking to Jesus, he's been drafted in a war. And the warning is, so you're not fighting with flesh and blood. The warning is for the note takers, Ephesians 6:12. We're not wrestling with principalities and those things in the flesh and blood. We're wrestling with principalities, powers, and all those crazy things. And in the 2 Corinthians 10, the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. You will not fight this thing the way the world fights this thing. Christ didn't forbid him to tell anybody else. He just told him, don't go back into that town. Don't go back among those people because Christ knew the hearts of the people that were there and that they weren't going to listen to what he was saying. And so, Pastor Don, I like Columbo, I have just one more thing I want us to see. Just one more thing. Verse 22 and verse 26. In verse 22, he took him outside of the village. Verse 26, he told him, don't go back to the village. Jesus wasn't even welcome in his own town. So he understood, I would, because you carry my DNA, your hometown is not going to hear you because they're not listening to me. That's why he took him outside in the first place. We see Jesus demonstrating how and in what method those healed by his grace. Come on. It was his grace that healed them. They came and told him, Jesus, you can heal him like this. Jesus was like, all right, took the man by the hand, took him out of town, healed him the way he saw fit. So we need to understand, we can't tell him how to do things. We think, oh, he's supposed to do it like this all the time. Don't put God in a box. And so it shot the, let me read what I had here. At first, their knowledge is confused. That's the first time. Remember, I see men as trees. He touched them again. They see men as trees walking. But like the light of the morning, it shines more and more to the perfect day. And then they see things clearly. And we can say, I can see clearly now, according to Proverbs 4:18. But the path of the uncompromisingly just and righteous. That's you, Double Portion Kingdom Ministries. We're trying to get you to mature in understanding that you are called to be the just. You are called to be the righteous, and allow your path is going to bright up like the light of dawn that shines more and more brighter and clearer until it reaches its full strength and glory, the perfect day to be prepared. God, we thank you that we can say, like the psalmist, I can see clearly now. We thank you that we've discussed a lot of things on this morning, and we thank you that Mark 8 will never be the same to us, that we understand, God, that it is a parable answering and showing us your compassion. We thank you, God, that we understand that we are called to be fishers of men just like you. And we thank you, God, that some things we do publicly, but some things we have to pull to the side. And we thank you for every blind person, every person whose sight and vision is blurry, whether it was from birth, whether it was from murmuring and complaining, whatever it was from disease, from being bitten by fiery serpents. We thank you, God, that we will believe Elohim, God, we will beg of you to touch us, God, that our vision will be made clear. God, we thank you that we will be led by your hand. Holy Spirit, lead us, guide us wherever I need to be. All I know is I'm tired of being blind. I'm tired of not seeing things the way they ought to be seen. Thank you for placing your DNA and commingling your DNA in with me, God. Thank you that you are my heavenly Father. We give you the glory. We give you the honor. We give you the praise. That no longer do I see men as trees. No longer do I see through rebellious eyes, through religious eyes, through even eyes of witchcraft. But I see with clarity of oneness, God, that men are drawn into you. And if perchance I was bitten by murmuring and complaining, I gaze upon the brazen serpent, upon the cross of Calvary, upon Jesus Christ, and I look at you attentively, expectantly, with a steady and an absorbing gaze, God, that I may live, that I may walk out, that I may share the compassion of Jesus Christ to touch people in the eye one more time for you. I thank you for restoration and wholeness and clarity coming forth on this day called today in Jesus' name. If there is anyone that is online with us or that is watching the YouTube and you understand, you can't see the eye chart. You can't see clearly. It's blurred because of life. The cares of this world, circumstances have come. And understand this, your servant Paulette Denise is not sitting before you without problems. I have aches and pains and wounds going on, and Jesus done spit all over me. His hand is upon me, and I will go forward and do what he's placed me in the earth realm for such a time as this to do. We cannot let the dramas and conflamas and cares of this world stop us from fulfilling purpose. God, you get the glory. You get the honor. You get the praise. Thank you. So if there's someone, this is a place for you to recommit your heart to that brazen serpent. This is a place for you to say, no longer will I look to the world. No longer will I look for an apology from somebody for something. I get my forgiveness together, me and God. I run my forgiveness through the cross of Calvary, and a person is forgiven whether I speak to them or not. Help us, God, renew our mind, heal our memories, heal our thought patterns and everything that would trigger us to operate in hurt, bitterness, and unforgiveness because of something that happened to us when we were bit by a serpent. But we're yet alive in the land of the living, so we come repenting, and repentance says, I need help, Jesus, I need you. I need you, Jesus. And in receiving Jesus, I receive the help of the Holy Spirit that they keep telling me about. Holy Spirit, speak to me. Holy Spirit, illuminate my world in this time and in this season. God, I thank you. And if there's someone that has never accepted Jesus, this is the time for you to say, Jesus, I receive you as my Savior from this sin-sick world. And I receive the help of Holy Spirit to illuminate to me the plan of salvation and everything that I need to know and understand to operate as a believer of the Lord Jesus Christ, not just a church attender, but a believer. That's what we're calling for, disciples of Christ. We're not asking you to join Double Portion. We've never even asked for membership for Double Portion Kingdom Ministries. We thank you. Your membership is into the kingdom of heaven, and therefore we can be used as kingdom conduits to help one another, to clean out you as a conduit for the kingdom to flow wherever you go. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And bless God. God, I thank you for what you're doing. You get the glory. You get the honor. You get the praise as I yield this call over to Pastor Don. God, you get it. We just thank you for what you're doing. Hallelujah.
Amen. Hallelujah. 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 I can see clearly now. Wow. Pastor Paulette, you just open that up for us, and just you know, I understand that text now in a way that I never understood it before. She talked about being commingled with your DNA with Christ and seeing spiritual, but then she went back to miraculous compassion, and that's what it's all about, people of God, is walking this thing out with compassion. You know, we as people of God, we talked about it last week a little bit when we said that God was putting us on display and people are watching. They're saying, well, you are a man or you are a woman of God. Are you walking with compassion? In other words, are you loving on people? Are you loving on people? That's what Jesus was about. He was about love. The Bible says that love covers a multitude of sin. So love, are you walking in love? But then she went on to say that even Jesus went fishing. Amen. So each and every one of us, you are a fisherman for Jesus. We're fishers of men, you know. And then she talked about the blind and the darkness and the smoke. Come on, people of God, this is a time in the history of the world where the enemy is allowing the media to infiltrate your thoughts and your eyes with a smoke screen. You can't believe everything you see on CNN. Don't get drawn into that, okay? We are people of God. And God says that we walk by faith and not by sight. So don't allow the things that you're seeing in the media to be the driving force or to cause you to react in a certain way. They are watching. People are watching. We need to counteract the things that are in the media by being like the opening scripture said. We need to be on our knees. We need to seek his face. We need to turn from our wicked ways, but we need to humble ourselves and seek more of him and pray. People of God, if there was ever a time in our lives that we needed to pray, that time is right now. But then Pastor Paulette went on to say, and she made an acronym for the word beg, believe Elohim God. Come on. Come on, somebody. Believe Elohim God. James said it like this. He said it best. He said, pray, believe, and receive. People of God, I stopped by this morning to tell you that some of your prayers haven't been answered, or you haven't seen the manifestation of your prayers, or walk into the blessing because you don't truly believe Elohim God. You don't believe that God is big enough to answer that prayer that you prayed to him. Come on, somebody. You know, but then she talked about God's hands and his hands equaling his might. And she talked about his hands equaling his destiny or your destiny. People of God, it's all been decided. The Bible talks about that even before you were created, that God had thoughts and plans for you. I've stopped by this morning to tell you that God already knows the end of your story. He knows the end of your story. Now it's up to you to get in alignment with the Holy Spirit and you and him become one and march in a cadence so that you can walk into your destiny. But then she talked about something else when she talked about the hand of God. People always want to talk about the hand of God leading you, and they want to talk about the hand of God leading you to your destiny, but nobody wants to talk about the hand of God and the wrath of God and the punishment that comes when you don't walk the way you're supposed to be. Now, God isn't some mean, big, mean God sitting up there waiting to spank you, okay? But the Bible says that obedience is better than sacrifice. We all want to worship. We all want to praise. But it's time that we walk in obedience. And I stop by to give you this message by the Spirit of the living God. People of God, it's time that we don't just talk the talk, but we got to walk the walk. As I said last week, we're not valley dwellers, okay? And the only way that we can get to the mountaintop is if we walk the walk. In other words, our faith has to be not just in word, but in deed. It's time that we walk our faith out. Amen. We walk our faith out. And then she talked about that. Why are you laboring? The Bible says that only what you do for God will last. Are you on this double portion live stream every Sunday morning because out of a sense of obligation, because you feel that this is where you have to be, or are you here because this is where you want to be? What's your motive? Why do you do what you do? Amen. And then she broke the spit down, the spiritual DNA, and she said it's the salve of God. It's the healing balm of God. It's the salve of God. In other words, God's spit has healing properties. Come on, somebody, healing properties. So it's like the Neosporin. Come on. And God's spit. It heals you. But as it heals you, it does something else. And like we said last week, it puts running in your feet. Come on, because he deposits the Holy Ghost in you. But then she stopped and talked about murmuring and complaining. I got to be transparent. That murmuring and complaining, that's me. God is working on me. Don't judge me. I'm a work in progress. Amen. But a lot of the Israelites didn't make it to the promised land. Not because they weren't commissioned by God to get there, and not that the blessing wasn't on them, but because of their murmuring and complaining. People of God, in this tumultuous season of adversity in the world, be careful what comes out of your mouth. Are you speaking blessings or are you speaking curses? Hallelujah, somebody. Be careful what comes out of your mouth. Because of your spiritual DNA, because he put the spit on your eyes and because he took you out of blindness and now you can see, your words have power. Because the Bible says that you were created in the image of God. Come on, somebody. And if I was created in his image, and if he spoke back in Genesis and said, let it be, and there was, that means that I have the creative power of my creator that lives on the inside of me. So the words that I speak can create. Be careful what you say. Are you speaking curses or blessings? Are your words creating or are your words tearing down? Come on, somebody. And she ended with, when you go fishing, let your bait be the bait of compassion. What are you showing people out there? What are you using to draw them into the marvelous light? Let it be love. Let it be compassion. Hallelujah. God, we thank you. We thank you, God, that we, like the man that was born blind from birth, we don't know how you did it, but we know that you did it because we were once blind, but now we can see. So God, as we walk into our newfound sight, we ask that you anoint us with the power of the Holy Ghost so that we can navigate through this new water. I hear you, God. The Bible says that God is doing a new thing and it sprung up and can't you see it? God, we thank you for this new thing that you're doing. Hallelujah, God. And as the man of God said the other night, you can't put new wine in old wineskins. So God, we come thanking you, God, that you're softening up our wineskin so that as you deposit the new wine into us with the saliva on our eyes and your DNA, that we won't burst because of old tough skin. We give you glory. We give you honor. We give you praise. God, I cover each and every person in Double Portion Kingdom Ministries in the blood of Jesus this morning. We come washing you with the word of the living God. God, we pray a special prayer this morning for my friend, Bishop Frank Rush and his family. We pray for his children, Cherish and Garen, God, we cover that family in your blood. God, you said that weeping may endure for a night, but joy cometh in the morning. And God, we thank you, God, for the homegoing of Dr. Joanne Valley Rush. God, we thank you for the woman of God. We thank you for all of the deposits that she made in the people of God. We thank you for the deposits that she made in this ministry, in Double Portion, in this marriage, God. We give you glory that you allowed her, God, to cross our path on her way to heaven. So God, we thank you for the woman of God. We thank you for her life. And we pray, God, that each and every person within the sound of my voice is this week as they're in their private prayer time, that they cover the bishop and his family in love as he, hallelujah, God, did a fantastic job of eulogizing his wife. His good thing, as the bishop said, he went to Burger King one day when he was in college looking for a whale, but he found Joanne Valley Rush. He found his whopper. So God, we pray in the name of Jesus, God, that you cover him, God. Cover him in your blood. God, we thank you for what ears have heard and for what eyes have seen today on Double Portion. And we ask you, God, that you just stay with us, keep us safe on this journey, God, and go before us. We thank you for your angels. We thank you for everything that you're doing in this time, in this season. God, open the eyes of our heart, God, because we want to see you. It's in Jesus' name I pray. And the people of God say amen and amen. I'm going to open up the lines for just a little while this morning. Hallelujah and bless God. Open the eyes of my heart, God. We want to see you. Minister Vanessa Park, all the way from Little Rock, Arkansas. Good morning, my sister.
Good morning, Double Portion family. Oh, y'all, I was in the word on this morning. Sister Paulette, Pastor Don, I just want to give a thank you. And I also want to just share little things that's going on in my life. I want to thank you all even for the word. I want to thank y'all for the season of this pandemic or this COVID that we've been through. You asked the question a second ago, were you here because you wanted to be here or what? Well, I was here because I needed covering.
Out of the bush, shed it, bullshit. Yes, God.
I needed covering through the season. It's one thing to be able to attend church, and then it's when you are part of a ministry, and then you watch them on TV. But I'm one of those people that God has put an apostolic calling on my life, and I didn't realize it until the last couple of weeks when some things happened. And I've been, they used to call it church hopping. They used to call it like you're going here, you're going there, you're going here. Well, God has given me many gifts, talents, and time and tithing. So he gave me the T's. And so what I wanted to share with you, the Double Portion family this morning, is I found a new church home. It's called Stewards of Christ. Mm. It's a very small congregation. I'm usually in a mega church, but this is a church where I can work. This is a church where I can use my gift of singing and talent. And I do it on Wisdom Pearls every morning, but I want to be in real fellowship. And I'm in fellowship with the Double Portion as well as my brothers and sisters in Christ. And I have really missed you guys because I've been like, you know, busy on these last couple of Sundays. But I want to say I love you. Thank you for the word. My eyes have been open. I think I was blinded, but now I see. And I appreciate y'all. And give me prayer this morning as that I have heard God and that I'm obeying him according to his spirit. Amen.
Amen. You know, Minister Vanessa, I am not surprised with your move because I saw it in the like spirit already. Amen. You know, it's one thing when you're connected to people in the spirit, God will show you things for them, things, you know, that you don't necessarily have to tell them, but you just intercede that God opens their eyes so like they can see what you see. Amen. But the other thing is we definitely want to cover you. Everybody doesn't know, but we were supposed to be in your house today, but God did a shift, you know, because of some things that are going on. But just know that we are not there with you, but we are with you. Okay. Amen. We're with you. We're with Amen. You. We love you. And we thank God for your new assignment. And God, we cover the woman of God in the blood of Jesus. Now, God, you said that, I hear you, God, that many are called, but few are chosen. So, God, we thank you that you chose her for this assignment. Oh, God, we pray in the name of Jesus that you will ignite her afresh, God. Ignite her afresh. God, take her back to the place to where when she first fell in love with you. God, use her for your glory. God, I pray in the name of Jesus that you allow her little light to shine so all the world that can see, so that all the world can see. Now, God, take her to the deeper recesses of your heart. Take her to some places that she's never been before. Because God, now you know that you can trust her and you can use her for your glory. It's in Jesus' name I pray. I love you, my sister.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Call me this afternoon.
Yes.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. Anybody else want to come up and say something this morning? You got something on your mind? Oh, hold on. I'm trying to work this thing. Pray for me. Hallelujah. Bless God. Open the eyes of my heart. Okay, so since nobody want to say nothing, and we got over 20-something people on here, I'm about to start calling some names. All right, now. All right. Speak now or be called. All right. Okay, so I see Minister Ezekiel Williams. Are you awake and with us, sir? Minister Ezekiel, where are you? Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Minister Ezekiel Williams, okay, we know what that's going, what's going on there. Hallelujah, and bless God. Hallelujah. Yes, God, I hear you. I hear you. Okay. Pastor Brooks, are you in a place where like you can like speak this morning? Hallelujah. Open that. How are you? Good morning, sir. How are you, man? Good to hear your voice, my friend. How are you?
Hey, I'm doing great. Doing great. Thank God. Praise God. Give him the glory. Yes, I was just here getting ready. My wife had the same word as well today. It's been busy all week, but I just want to thank God for the awesome word Paulette always gave. You know, she always called herself a teacher. So I think that's how she says it. You know, and she teaches, you know, very well and very plain. But you can understand because, you know, you have to understand that when you're giving the word, you have to break it down for people to understand your word. So I just thank God for the word today. Thank God for you as well, for always being encouragement and reaching out. Even when I'm too busy to even do it myself, you know, I get tied up in other things that I just forget about people who's more concerned about you, who love you, who care about you. So I just pray to God to continue to just slow me down, you know, and continue to put him first and, you know, and just find the word to my life. But once again, I thank God for the word today, Pastor Paulette. Awesome word. God bless y'all. I love you.
Amen. Amen. And Pastor Paulette, you want to go ahead and cover Prophetess Tamikla as she brings the word this morning? You want to go ahead and cover that?
Amen. God, I thank you for my sister in the ministry, for my sister in faith. God, that you get the glory, the honor, the praise. God, I thank you that the word that she has prepared, God, even as she looks at the notes, that you will allow her to take a glance, take a look. You give her eyes to see clearly now, and then she will share that which you give her. I thank you for every rhema word that you quicken to her, to the woman of God. I thank you for the prophetic turning within. I thank you that she see with the eyes of the prophetic. Give her the eyes of a seer that will change each point to fit the people that are in the room, that she's coming like with the compassion of Jesus Christ. That's one thing that Tamikla Brooks is. She is a woman of compassion. And so I thank you for your compassion being on display through your servant Tamikla on today. You get the glory, you get the honor, you get the praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and bless God.
Amen. Thank you all. God bless you.
Amen. Love you, my friend. Hallelujah. Minister Ezekiel said he's with us, but he like has a sore throat. So Minister Ezekiel, we pray for healing. We decree and declare in the name of Jesus that by the stripes of Jesus that you are already healed. It's in Jesus' name. I pray. Professor, you wanted to come up. Hallelujah. Unmute, Professor.
Open that.
Can you hear me,
sir?
Now?
Yes, sir. Go right ahead.
I just want to say that this morning when Pastor Paulette went to murmuring and complaining, oh my God, you took me back to a time when my brother first came to Houston to live with me. My life turned into a series of murmuring and complaining. Because it was like, I can't do this. I had never been a caregiver before. I had never helped anybody that way. I had taught school for 35 years, high school and college. And I just kept crying out to God, God, help me, help me. I'm the only one here. I don't have any relatives, blood relatives here in Houston. And I need help, Lord. Please, Lord, help me. I just can't do it. I just can't do it, so much so. Until I had to call the doctor because of anxiety, and I was just allowing myself to get more and more filled with anxiety because the enemy had me without realizing I was looking at the wrong thing. I was not seeing clearly. I was not seeing what God wanted me to see. I was only seeing what the enemy wanted me to see and hear. But I want to say this morning, Pastor Paulette, you really, really, really opened up that message at that little section for Professor Sims. Because when you talked about, you know, seeing clearly, hearing clearly, I was just all off base during that time. I wasn't seeing clearly. I wasn't hearing clearly. I wasn't even listening clearly to God's word. I was reading, and some of the stuff that I was reading seemed to have been just going right over my head. I'm certain there are other people maybe on the line that have experienced that, because you get so caught up in what you're going through and what you're feeling on the inside, everything else becomes null and void. And when they brought my brother here, I wasn't prepared for that at all. If it had not been for my godson who stepped in and helped me to prepare, not help me, but got me prepared, got me ready for what I was about to go through, never realizing the fact that God knew all along the plan he had for me during that time. It had never even occurred to me that look to heaven, look to him. He got you. He understands. But I was so inundated with what I was going through that, as I said, everything else just became null and void. But I want to thank you, Pastor Paulette, because it's almost like you just carved that little section out for Professor this morning. And you really, you taught as you normally teach, you taught this morning in such a way that I am just even more clearer on what I'm going through and what is, it's lighter now. It's not as bad as it was. And I thank you, and I thank you every week that we get on the call for the call. And I just want to say, Father God, in the name of Jesus, we thank you this morning for being who you are in my life, where you are in my life, where you have grown me to be in my life right now. We thank you, the team, Pastor Paulette and Pastor Don, for I know you all study. I know you all prepare these lessons and these messages for the people on the line every Sunday morning. Because if you weren't, we wouldn't be getting out of our bed at 6 and 7 o'clock to hurry and get on the line. And almost now waiting for a Pastor Nine call, because he is going to call us and make certain that we are in position to receive the message that he and or Pastor Paulette is going to deliver. And I think it's just so special how you all have organized this situation on this line, where neither one of you are overpowering the other. You have it so equally laid out that sometime Pastor Paulette comes, and then other time Pastor Don lay back and supports her, you know. And I think that's such a God fixed thing, and we thank God for the two of you, because every time someone different come up, I was so glad to see Sister Vanessa this morning, and coming up with that wonderful word and giving her testimony of what has happened and what she's doing now. And she's such a great lady in my eyes, you know, to be so special in her ministry and what she's doing for the kingdom of God. Even though she's moved to another situation, she's still fighting for the kingdom. And so many others of you bless Professor all the time with what you have to say when you come up. I forgot the lady's name last week came up, and she had she came and she was so full, but then she had to come back and say, I'm better now, because the message had touched her in such a way that she just couldn't even, she was so full, she cannot even go forth with her message at that particular time. She had to collect herself. And that's because the messages are so well put together. It's because the messengers allow God to use them in such a way that we are all helped. We are all blessed in what's going on this line every Sunday morning. And trust me, I am truly, truly blessed every Sunday morning. So I want to say thank you all and everybody on the line. I pray for you all the time. And may God add a blessing to what's going on the line every Sunday morning. God bless all of you. Have a great rest of your day.
Amen. 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 Thank you so much, Professor, for those kind words. Those compassionate words. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Brother Stafford, did you want to say something, Brother Stafford? I saw you came off of mute for a second. Brother Stafford, did you need to say something? Press star 6 again, Brother Stafford, to come off of mute. There you go.
Okay. First, give them to God and everybody on the call to Pastor Dunn.
Uh-oh. His phone dropped in the middle of what he was saying. Brother Stafford, just go ahead and call back in. He's got something good to say. He'll call back in. He'll call back in. He'll call back in so that God can get the glory out of whatever it is he wants to say. Is there anyone else that wants to come up while we're waiting on Brother Staff to come back up? Brother John Smith, I see you there. We will actually be ministering in Abbeville, Louisiana on September 26th, I think it is, John, but I'll talk to you about that in some more depth later. But yeah, we will be in your neck of the woods in September. So we definitely want you to come out and meet us and, you know, support us, man, as we go to minister. Paulette will be ministering in dance, and I'll be bringing the word at Mount Triumph Baptist Church in Abbeville, Louisiana on September 26th, I think it is. Amen. Hallelujah. Waiting on Brother Stafford to come back. Is there anybody else that wants to come up while we try to wait on Brother Stafford to come back up? Hallelujah. Got you. Uncle Richard, go ahead.
Well, first of all, good morning to everyone. And I just was listening to some of the things that Paulette said, but I can see clearly now. But, you know, she say, are you just listening at this program, or what are you getting out of it? I'm part of this program, and I love it to death. So that's why I'm up out of the bed. I'm sure the professor feels the same way as he expressed himself. And I want to let you know that it's such a wonderful job that you all do on Sunday mornings. And Sister Vanessa, I could see that look in her eyes, that it's the Lord's work. Like he moved our step by step, and he put it out. I could see the expression on her face that she's going, well, good Lord sending her to do things the right. And this is what it's about. It's about doing the work of the Lord and being obedient. And, you know, I'm just thrilled every morning. You know, and sometimes I wonder why we don't do it all week. But that's another faith for another day. But God bless Paulette and Don. And y'all just keep doing what you're doing. And we love you. And we will always love you and support you.
Amen. Thank you so much, Uncle. That's, you have no idea what you and Aunt Mabel support means. You know, people will, you know, follow you, but when your family follows you, that's a whole different feeling. That's a whole different level of compassion, a whole different level of love. So we love you. Keep us in your prayers. Like I say, you know, we're traveling. We will be leaving Dallas tomorrow. So just keep us in your prayers. Amen. Yeah. Hallelujah.
And keep praying.
Yes, sir. Let's see. Is Brother Stafford back? Did he get back? Okay. So Brother Stafford, Stafford, are you with us?
Hello. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, go right ahead. I apologize. I got dropped off the call.
Yes, first, sir. No worries.
God and everybody, Pastor Paulette, Pastor Dunn, I just want to thank God for Double Portion Ministry, and I want to rededicate my life to Jesus this morning. And I have a testimony. I was talking and fellowshipping with Pastor Dunn, and God blessed me, and I called him, and I was able to pay my tithes. And he came to my house when he got off his work day, and I was able to pay my tithes. And I just want to thank him for picking my tithes up and sowing it to Double Portion Ministry. And I want to thank you guys for the message this morning. And I just thank you guys. Just thank you, everybody, for listening to me this morning. Amen.
You want to pray right there? Rededication. Hallelujah. Go ahead and pray.
So, God, we pray right now. We lift Stafford up to you, and we thank you that you have blessed Double Portion Kingdom Ministries with the assignment to cover this man of God's life. So we cover him, and we thank you for that cry, that call for rededication. So Jesus, we thank you that it is you that is touching his spiritual eyes with your salve, with your eye salve. And thank you, God. I come against every spirit of religion that's trying to hold him in bondage. God, I thank you for every wound that he has experienced, even with the passing of his son and of his child and different things that have taken place, God. I thank you that those things are things that happen to us in the earth realm, but you, oh God, can heal us from every wound, every bruise, everything that hurts us, God. You are here to heal us. And I thank you that Stafford Demichet's eyes are open to see clearly into the spirit realm. And so I thank you, God, that every question that he has, he realizes that he has Holy Spirit living, resident right within him, that he can ask those questions of you, even in the midnight hour. Staff, I'm hearing this between 12 a.m. and 3 a.m. Holy Spirit will wake you up to commune with you and to show you some things about this rededication, that you are stepping into a place of clarity, of seeing clear. And so we thank you, God. We glorify you. We magnify you for the man of God's life. Heaven rejoices over one sinner repenting, and we, the Double Portion, come and we're rejoicing that one of ours is saying, yes, I want to rededicate my life afresh and anew, all over again to God. God, you get the glory in Jesus' name. And you know what? This is not a second time or a third time. This is another time. So anytime that we choose to come and rededicate our lives, not just because something bad was going on, but because we see you in new dimensions. So we come and rededicate our lives. I rededicate my life afresh and anew to you with the pieces of my history that you have shown me just in the last 6 months to see. I rededicate it all afresh and anew unto you. We, the Double Portion Kingdom, we come rededicating our lives afresh and anew. There were so many things and pieces that occurred in our lives that we did not understand as we walked through it. But now we thank you for eyes to see what was really going on, that you get the glory and the honor and the praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and bless you, God.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Welcome home. Welcome, welcome, welcome home, my brother. You know, this is a line of transparency, and so I'm sure Minister Ezekiel won't mind me sharing a little bit of his story. But staff, about a year or two ago, Minister Ezekiel was exactly where you are in life. Get this, exactly where you are in life, as far as your living situation, as far as seeking God for like a vehicle. He was exactly in the same spot you are. And I've come by this morning since he like has a sore throat to tell a little bit of his story. He's now in his own place with his own vehicle, with a job, and, you know, he's doing well. So, you know, just know that God is no respecter of person, and what he does for one, he will do for the other one. And, you know, we're just walking out our testimonies. God is customizing our testimony, because the word says in the book of Revelation, somebody asked, who were those people? And somebody said, those are the ones that have overcame. They've overcame by the blood of the Lamb, which you just did. You just rededicated yourself, and by the words of their testimony. So continue to pray, continue to be faithful. And as you and I spoke to, about a couple weeks ago, obedience is better than sacrifice. Walk in the spirit of obedience, but walk in the spirit of love, and watch God work it all out for your good. Hallelujah, and bless God. Will there be another one this morning before we go into our announcements and close? Does anyone else have anything else they would like to say this morning? Hallelujah. Bless God. If you're on the phone lines, you have to hit star six and then unmute your phone as well. anyone else's Father. Hallelujah. Well, if there be none others, Pastor Paulette, can you give me some slides? Hallelujah and bless God. Hallelujah and bless God. Remember, people of God, we used to be blind, but now we can see. So now is a season that we have to be, I hear you. We have to be as wise as a dove, okay? So we have to navigate this season in love, but we have to keep our spiritual eyes on. We have to walk in the spirit of discernment because there's so much going on in the spiritual realm. There's a lot of activity, some of it positive on the Lord's side, but a lot of it is coming from a place other than from the spirit of the Lord. So you have to be wise and walk with Holy Spirit so that you can know what's going on around you. Amen. So we'll go back to the slides this morning. Hallelujah. And bless God. After the slides, please. Thank you. Hallelujah. And bless God. Thank you so much. Okay. Hallelujah. So as we said, on Thursday, the 12th, we'll have a birthday Zoom for Pastor Paulette at 7 p.m. on the Zoom. Same bed station, same bed channel, August 12th at 7 p.m. Join us at Zoom, and I'll definitely send out a reminder for that. Thursday next week, Thursday, August 19th. Flock of men, we're coming your way at 8 p.m. Central Time. So if you got some men on your list, you got some men in your family, you know, whatever, I'm going to actually send this flyer out to everybody, not just the men. And if the ladies would want to pass it on to men in their family, please do so. So, keep in mind and start to register right now for the Double Portion Kingdom Ministries Spring Identity Retreat. April 1st through 3rd in Monroe, Louisiana. Your life will never be the same. Amen. Follow us on YouTube at PauletteX7. And you can email us at PauletteX7@gmail.com, or you can text either one of us for your prayer requests or praise reports. If that be all, I'm going to turn it over to Pastor Paulette, give us some closing words, and close us out with our closing benediction, please, ma'am. Thank you.
Amen. One thing that I heard several times through the comments on this morning is accountability. The thing about accountability is accountability shows us, it's a powerful sign of maturity. Being accountable and stating I'm not available. And so I know that a lot of you on the line, when Pastor Don sends the flyer out, you text back and say, oh, I'm not gonna be able to make it or whatever. You contact us and let us know I'm gonna be offline a few weeks. Or even Bishop Rush, he texted us and let us know I'm focusing on some other things, but he blessed us and still was here all the way up. So thank you, everyone. I want you to know that that is a sign of maturity. And then Uncle Richard, thank you so much for being the representative. Even as was spoken in the scripture this morning, Jesus was not accepted by his own family. He wasn't accepted in his own hometown. And so to have family come along and to join, thank you so much. And I do have my niece Malia that does go back and watch the playbacks, and she texts me and says, Auntie, that was good. And so it's something when family is here with us, and we don't take that for granted. I just wanted to come back and give a second thank you to that. Thank you so much for your support. We appreciate it. We are going to close this morning with a song. Professor, get ready. This is going to bless us real good as God blesses us with this psalm on this morning. But as we close, we will close with the priestly blessing that states, may God bless you. May he make his face shine upon you. He will bless you real good with eyes that see in this time and in this season. And we, your Double Portion Kingdom Ministries family, say shalom.
Saying that, I want her to release that, then I want her to close us out in prayer. yeah. I was thinking. I've been through a lot, and I'm so very encouraged. Hey, I don't have no doubt about it in my mind. I've already made it. Thank you, Jesus. Yeah. It's all is over now. Thank you, Jesus. It's over now. No doubt about it. I know. I have made it over. I want you all over the world tonight to be encouraged, because God is with you. You are going through, you have gone through the storm and the rain. But I want you to be encouraged tonight. God got you in his hand. Whatever problem that you are facing, put it in the hand of the Lord. Whatever you're dealing with, whatever sickness in your body, God is a healer on tonight. Put it all in the hands of the Lord. Claim it, believe it, in the name of Jesus. It's over now. In the name of Jesus, it's over now. Oh, yes, it is. Hey, I want you to help me sing. It's all over.
It's over now.
Be encouraged on.